So this is my trend review. So I guess I'll start up over here where there's a climax. So over here you have this rally, which is really a climax. And it's very difficult to go short within here because, I mean, some people will actually sell, you know, when there is a strong rally because they think of reversion to the mean or something like that, but not for a trend trader. A trend trader will very likely buy pullbacks. So this area here, you know, this is a support area, or in my opinion, it would be some type of reaccumulation here. You can see that this area would have high volume. If you bring up a volume profile against these levels, they would show that this has a decent amount of volume. Anyway, so you have this expansion, this rally, and then you have all of this. This point here, here and here, this is the low volume pullback. It's very evident from taking a look at the rally, and then you see the low volume pullback. Like, see how it's going down? So you have low volume pullback. So this is the point where the market is on a springboard to go higher. And demand comes in, but it's unable to go higher. So it failed. So that piece of behavior is very important because that is telling you something. That when that market was ready to rally, was ready to go, and failed, like that's very important information. Okay? And what happened was when it attempted to rally, see the blue, and failed, red, selling came in here. Now the game gets interesting. Because at this point here, you have your first indication of supply within this trend. That is the first indication of supply. So you have 46 down, 11 up. 46 down, 11 up. What is that? 4-to-1 ratio. So you have 46 down, 11 up, and I think this is a thrust, and it goes lower. And then how much do you have? Why is this important? Because now you're at a support area. But like it went down on heavy volume, hit the support area, and what did it bounce on? 11. So you have 46 down, hit the support area, bounces on 11. What's it telling you? It means that this support is not support. No buyers. So it breaks and then it tries to rally again and finds no demand. Okay. After that, it moves sideways. And for those who are, you know, a little experienced, they know this behavior and what it is. This is effort reward. Now, a lot of people say, oh, no, effort reward is just a bar with big volume and doesn't make progress. This is effort reward. All right. Why? 34 effort cannot go above the prior minor upwave on 11 volume. You have three times the volume. 34 is more than three times 11. Yet it is unable to rally above the prior minor upwave on 11, even though it has three times the volume. That is why it is effort reward. All right. Okay, so that piece of behavior is critical, and it's confirmed by the rally that goes down on 50 something volume. So, you know, you got to mark this area because why do you have to mark it? It's because there's spots that represent failure, okay? Meaning the market attempted to go up or down and failed. The retest of those areas is very lucrative because it is very likely that if it failed, it will fail on the retest. All right. So off this support level, it rallied and failed and rallied and failed, tried with more than three times the volume of the prior rally and failed. So this zone, this area, is a very good area to take shorts off of because there are multiple attempts, they failed. I was just telling you, this shit is not going to go higher. Okay, so it goes down on 58, and then it goes rallies and pullback and rally. And, you know, traders know. They know that this failed here. So when it goes into that area, they sell, creating a rally. We create that rally down, goes up, and then rallies again down. So now let's take a look at the volumes. Again, red volume is greater, so selling volume is greater. There's no change of behavior. There's no evidence of any strength whatsoever. Instead, what you have is 35, 12, 24, 24. Like, do you see any evidence of strength? None. On the sell side, you have like 45 and another 45. So you see sell volume is much stronger, right? Look at that, and just look at this entire area. Which wave's bigger? Selling is much bigger. Now, the problem is that what people will do is say, oh, no, no, but look over here, the selling is only 12, 12, 12. Doesn't that mean the selling is weak? No, selling has already proved itself. Okay, these small down waves don't mean nothing because selling has already proved itself in the background and with the trend. It's like this law, once in motion, it stays in motion until an equal and opposite force counteracts it. So the selling force is here. There's enough inertia. There's enough inertia to continue down. The selling force, the impulse is all already baked in. So these small selling waves, they don't matter. The car is already moving down. It's up for demand. It's up to demand to take out the selling with strong, man, hold on. All right, I'm back. Anyway, so selling has already, oh, shit, hold on. All right, sorry about that. All right, where was I? Anyway, so the selling pressure is already established. So the small selling waves don't think that they're bullish. The small selling waves, you could throw out the window. They mean nothing. They can even be ignored or pretend like they're not there. Pretend like the only thing you see is the red waves. The blue waves have to become bigger than the red waves to establish dominance. Oversupply. That's how it works. So what you see is sell, and then where the hell is the demand? There is no demand, all right? So what happens is, how did I miss this? I'm just thinking, like, how I missed this trade up here. Anyway, so over here, this one was also an area where you had lack of demand. And because you had lack of demand, selling just came right back in. Because the demand is unable to prove itself. And you get higher prices in this correction, right? And they sell. Over here on the right-hand side, you have lack of demand, and a breakdown. So finally, you got the damn signal. So it goes down, and it's on very, very heavy volume. Now, one of the things that you want to always look for or keep in mind is the background, the volume in the background. So over here, the biggest volume in the background is right here, 58. Okay, now that's near the top of the downtrend. It's the big ass volume near the top of the downtrend, right? So let me ask you, like, if this is smart money selling near the highs, right, over here or here, typically I think over here, right, 46 and 58, you know, when you sell, you want to sell high. You don't want to sell low, right? So why is it that the volume after many, many waves is double? Why is that? If you're smart or smart money, wouldn't you sell this much at higher prices? At better prices instead of selling after multiple waves down at worse, lower prices? Well, that's because smart money is selling the highs and not so smart money is selling here. That's why. Meaning you could have high volume, but when it's near highs, that's smart money. The same selling near the lows is not smart money. It's actually public. And it is the result of fear of missing the move, FOMO, where they can't take it anymore. So, I mean, you know what's going on here, right? The market opened. And it's going down and down and down. So they're waiting. After an hour, hour and a half, it gets the best of them. And they're like, it's okay, fine. Let me just sell. So that's what happens. And this is, you have to be careful. Now, it doesn't always have to be there, but like one of the things to look for is why is the volume great? Near the later part of the trend, equal or more than at the top part of the trend. So keep these high volume numbers near the top part of a downtrend in mind and question why later on you have a climax. Because volume is volume. It's high, up or down, but who is doing what in that volume? What does it mean? Like, technically, you will never know. Because if it's red bar is a red bar, a big number is a big number. Right? But when you apply judgment, you'll understand that, smart money sells highs, not so smart money sells lows. In any case, so this was the climax, and over here, you had... You know, I don't know what this is, but it definitely started forming some type of left-hand side. Or it looked like some type of, I don't know if it's support or see on a base, there's like the part in the middle, and then a part on the left and the right. If this was on the right-hand side of a base, they would call it last point of support, right? And if it's on the left side, I guess they call it preliminary support or something like that. But understand, like, this is meaningful, okay? Because this block has high volume. Something, even though the numbers are small, understand within this range, you have multiple waves up and down. So cumulatively, within this area of price between this level and this level, because there's so many overlapping bars and there is time involved, overlapping bars and time involved, it is a high volume area. Okay, it doesn't matter what the numbers say. The numbers are just pointing one at one candle. Understand that when candles or bars are overlapping each other within a tight area, that area is high volume. And you have to ask yourself, why are they overlapping? Is it because he's buying 500, then selling three, then buying 500, then selling three, then buying 500, then selling three? Is it reaccumulation, or is it initial accumulation? What is it? Why is it like that? So typically, they want a tight range. And actually, not really, because it depends on how big the move is. For larger moves, they need bigger ranges, right? But this action here is meaningful. After that, you have some selling. And you see that the waves are they getting bigger? And smaller. And it start moving sideways. Now here's the more important part. Okay, after all these waves, you finally get this 1, 2, 3, 4. This is something that should stick out like a sore thumb. Now it's not massive volume, but this is initial accumulation. Do you know whether this is initial accumulation? No. You know it after the fact. But what will stick out to you is that there is volume there. Do you know if it's initial accumulation? You don't know things until market proves itself. You know, so you have to just have a flexible perspective which can hold the possibility that there is something going on. This is a base, this is a base, and in this base, you finally have the biggest up volume since the trend, right here. And then finally, when it comes back down to these levels, it's not breaking, and you have this rally. Was there any indication that this rally would have happened? Not really. Like, this came out because of news that there was the tariff. You know, there's like tariffs against Canadian aluminum and steel that are being considered, and I think European. But the thing is, like, do you have any other? The only thing you had was maybe some background information, because there was a strong rally that came from this area here. And like there's a block right here that was untested. So let's see. See that area. Oh shit. So it actually just tested that area and formed a accumulation. So they accumulated off of the test of the prior day's action. So that was, I mean, that is the level I should have marked. It actually marked it a bit higher with this brown line, because I have it automatically done. Anyway, so they accumulated off the test of that area. Then they used the tariff news and did this rally. This rally just bye. It went up, and this is an interesting rally because sometimes, you know, the move is like one rally climax. So, you know, it's like this: you move up too far, too fast. The market is in a weak technical position. This qualifies for a move that's too far, too fast. Relatively speaking, the range of this rally is way too big, and short sellers and those who believe in reversion to the mean, they'll be all over something like this. So you have this rally, you have this follow-through rally, which doesn't make much progress. You have another attempt on 12. Now it gets interesting, like, because you have a rally like this, and look at the follow-through. Look at what happened to demand. On multiple attempts, mind that, like, there's multiple attempts, but there's no demand. This is in an overbought condition. And people, you know, they don't want to buy it higher. So what happens? Naturally, it pulls back, it tests, pulls back, tests. At this point, right there, the market is on a springboard. Now, the thing is, when you're on a springboard, price can shoot up and enter markup, and you're not really sure how far the markup is going to go. Okay, a rally like this, you know, it can really be very strong, significant markup. But what happens is this block over here served as resistance. So it rallies into this block and is unable to clear it. It won't be able to clear it until the process of absorption takes place in this area and takes these guys out. So, like, there's no absorption that goes. It just hits this area in resistance and pulls back. And it pulls back. And it pulls back, and it pulls back, and we're done for the day. But understand that, you know, this area, those who knows how to identify that area, how to identify this area, know how to identify the springboard. So this is a springboard that initiated markup, but that markup was unable to get past resistance. And then there was another springboard which occurred right here, but it failed. Down, low volume, attempt, failed. And the interesting thing is, like, on the bull side, this bullish springboard failed, but there was actually another springboard here on the bearish side. The concept of a springboard is there's a number of examples in Wyckoff's course, but there's many manifestations of springboard, but the typical one is like a rally followed by a low volume pullback. That's like, I think that was the first example that Wyckoff gave. So you see this rally followed by low volume pullback. What rally, the 71 rally with the 11 pullback. Obviously, it's a low volume pullback, so it's on a springboard, right? After multiple corrective waves. Here, you have 46 and you have 11. Obviously, 11, 46, 4-to-1 ratio. It's on a springboard. Again, here you have 170, I think. And then it goes down to 11 and 11. So one of these two would qualify as going to an area of low volume and the market being on the springboard. See? These are the when price comes back down, the volume starts drying up. Therefore, it's on a springboard position. That's one approach, and that's during the correction after multiple waves. So that's one manifestation of a springboard. The other, I think you mentioned, was the apex. So, you know, eventually, I don't like to use triangles because I think that I'm not into the patterns because you really have to understand behavior and stay away from patterns because everything will look like a pattern. Really, your mind will trick you into thinking everything is a pattern. But anyway, what you want to see is a narrowing of ranges. So what that looks like is the narrowing of ranges automatically looks like a triangle. So like if it's rising and the ranges are narrowing, it look like this. So they call it an ascending wedge, right? Because it's narrowing here. If it's going down and then is narrowing, right? So then it's called a descending wedge. It's all bullshit. Like, the point is not the wedge, but like the fact that the in here it's narrowing. In here it's narrowing. And then when you have a regular triangle, it's the same thing. The narrowing is what matters. Here it's narrowing towards the top, here's narrowing towards the bottom, and here it's narrowing right in the middle. The point is that it's narrowing, and when you have price that narrows, you can see that the springboard has been created. Like, you see that? It looks like a springboard. Like, this is springboard. But remember that, like, it's not just the narrowing. You have to look at the volume and the background to then consider, okay, is the market on the springboard or not? And sometimes the springboards fail. Like over here, it failed on the long side, but on the short side, it set up. And this was an interesting springboard on the short side because it included the behavior of effort reward. Right. That was a nice springboard. Here, I don't want to call this like some type of reaccumulation, but I would say it's like at a minimum, this would be a broad range of support, because you have 1, 2, 3, 4, broad range of support, and then you have a low volume pullback, followed by a thrust, initiates markup, but unable to take out the resistance area, so it pulls back. And I tried again, but it didn't really do anything. Anyway, so today's lessons on my trend review is really important. You know, I use these reviews to kind of bring to the surface a lot of ideas I have that I learned from understanding the course material. I'm out of here.